oil and gas industry started this fracking boom. And at first they were encroaching into neighborhoods and into backyards.
Not in our backyard, not in anyone's backyard. Get the frack out of our lives.
Now their emissions, their pollution that they release from these sites is a problem for everyone around the globe because methane is a very powerful greenhouse gas.
The Permian Basin in Texas, it's by far the most productive field in the country. I think more than half the country's drill rigs were operating there over the past few years. And Sharon Wilson goes out there every couple months with this camera that can see methane, this invisible pollutant.
If you could see the emissions with your naked eye, there never would have been a fracking boom. You cannot see it without this camera.
If you think about the fossil fuels that are down in the ground, one of the main ones is actually methane. And what we refer to as natural gas is essentially a combination of gases that come up from the ground that are mostly methane, with a few other gases thrown in there. Methane is a super powerful greenhouse gas. It has about 80 times the global warming potential of carbon dioxide over a 20-year period. And scientists think that about a quarter of all the human-caused warming that we've experienced to date is because of methane emissions by humans. We do a lot of different things to put methane in the atmosphere. Raising livestock is a big contributor. Growing rice is another one. Landfills, sewage, there's all different kinds of things. And then, of course, oil and gas.
There's a new unconventional process for extracting natural gas from shale.
In the early 2000s, there were these combination of innovations in how we drill for oil and gas. We sometimes refer to it as fracking.
We drill way, way deep, past the water table, as far as 2 miles. And we drill horizontally through that shale.
And one of the things that did was it caused natural gas to be way more abundant and cheap than it ever was before.
We're pulling almost 750 million cubic feet of natural gas a day.
Fracking has revolutionized the US energy market.
Natural gas, if you burn it in a power plant, it emits about half the carbon of coal. So that kind of looks like a real positive for the environment. The risk with that is that we didn't really know how much methane might be escaping prior to being burned in a power plant. So now we know that the Permian, the basin as a whole, is emitting about 2.9 million metric tons of methane a year. If you think about how much warming that gas is causing, it's about the same as the entire state of Florida, all the human-caused emissions in, you know, one of our most populous states. I was curious about finding some of the lowest hanging fruit in terms of climate action. Some of the things that the world is going to have to do to slow the pace of global warming are difficult. The methane problem in the oil and gas industry is relatively tractable. It involves essentially preserving something that the industry is wasting that it could be selling for money. So I went out to the Permian Basin in May. And I drove around for a few days with Sharon Wilson.
Uh-oh, these guys are gonna be pissed because I am gonna get out and take a video of their site.
I'm a certified optical gas imaging thermographer and a field advocate for earthworks. I use an optical gas imaging camera. It's manufactured by FLIR, which stands for Forward Looking Infrared.
It's a $100,000 camera that uses infrared sensors to produce an image that shows methane.
I make visible the invisible emissions out here to prove that the oil and gas industry is not containing their methane gas.
I'm seeing a lot of emissions coming from the tank valves. Sometimes the industry will say that's steam,
That's just an excuse industry makes. So they use the same camera that we use. They don't use it to go find steam.
Sharon was not really an environmentalist. She used to work for an oil services company back in the day. And she had this beautiful place out in the country. She was raising her boys there. And she really blamed fracking for kind of ruining the air and water in her area. And so she became sort of mobilized to do something about it.
When my water turned black, no one came. Because if it has to do with oil and gas, no one's coming. You're on your own. So I didn't want other people to go through that.
We went out towards Pecos, Texas, which is near the heart of where the oil boom has been kind of happening in the last few years. A lot of the Permian is just miles and miles away from a public road, and the roads are just kind of built by the oil companies and off limits to the public. And so there's a lot of kind of driving around, figuring out how to get places.
I don't see a sign that says no trespassing. I don't know, what do y'all think? All they can do is come at us on their four-wheeler with a rifle.
I didn't know whether we would find any methane. I mean, most of these emissions are evidence of something going wrong. Maybe we'd strike out. But, you know, Sharon has done this a lot. She was pretty confident. And we found lots of events every day. Methane, it's just kind of everywhere. So we're out here in the Permian Basin at night. We're not far from Pecos, Texas. And across the street from us is a well site. And to the unaided eye, it looks pretty normal. Give you a look. But now we'll show you what Sharon Wilson sees through her optical gas imaging camera. That's what the camera sees is coming up from the top of the flare. An unlit flare. It's confounding because, of course, natural gas is a useful fuel that people pay money for. It's not really in anyone's interest to waste it. But gas is very difficult to handle. It's hard to store, it's hard to transport. It's easy for pressure to build up somewhere and you have to release it somehow. So in places like the Permian Basin, you see a lot of giant flares that are burning natural gas. It sounds kind of like a jet engine. If you burn the gas, obviously that's not great for the environment because you're putting carbon dioxide into the air. But releasing it without burning it is something like 16 times as bad because then you're releasing methane rather than carbon.
When a flare goes out, it just becomes a big vent pipe and it vents methane gas to the atmosphere.
We found leaks both from places she'd been to before that were still problematic and new places we just stumbled across. There's pretty significant emissions coming from the top of this row of tanks that you see behind me.
Volatile organic compounds and methane gas. I wouldn't want to live downwind.
So we put a lot of miles on today, drove around to a lot of sites, and it turns out it's actually pretty easy to find these emissions if you just look around this part of the country with a camera that can see them.
Once we have the footage, we submit complaints to the TCEQ, the Texas Regulatory Agency. I've made over 240 complaints, and even if they take action, it doesn't last. But until something changes, we'll keep doing this.
Sharon has probably done more than anyone else to kind of publicize the problem in the Permian. But Sharon's work is kind of scattershot in a way because her goal is to find problems and publicize them. A lot of other people out there are focused on what can we do to clean it up. So Environmental Defense Fund, you could think about what they're doing in the Permian as sort of like dispatching a thousand Sharon Wilsons, hitting hundreds and hundreds of sites in a systematic way to try to put some kind of scientific credibility behind their findings.
So in this case, it potentially could be a safety hazard in addition to...
So I went to Austin, Texas to visit David Lyon, who's running EDF's Permian project.
What have you found so far?
We found that emissions in the Permian are very high. We find that about 5% of these flares are unlit and venting all the methane to the atmosphere, and about another 5% have combustion problems. I did expect some flares to be unlit, but was shocked that consistently we're finding at least 5% are unlit and venting, so showing that this is a ubiquitous major problem in the basin.
What's the hope that you'll be able to accomplish?
So really we have two goals. One is to have the data inform regulators so they can design effective policies. We also want to have actions by the operators in the Permian, so they would make changes to their sites which would minimize the occurrence of those kinds of issues in the future.
The industry is kind of under attack from all sides right now. Last year, the French government essentially vetoed a $7 billion deal to import liquefied natural gas from the Permian because of concerns about the greenhouse gas profile. And that really sent a shockwave through the energy industry. And at the same time, these companies are catching it from their investors and lenders. So Wall Street banks and asset managers are really pushing these companies to do something about their emissions profile. If you look at what oil companies are saying publicly, they are saying almost uniformly that they're very focused on this problem.
We're wide awake about the dangers of climate change. We put very stringent targets on methane.
It's absolutely critical that we as a company get this right, and frankly, we as an industry get this right.
We are ready to curb our emissions, and we will do it together for a better and sustainable future.
So BP, they've been doing a lot to change up how their whole infrastructure works there to reduce the amount of methane that they're leaking, reduce the amount of gas that they're flaring. They say that this changeover is going to cost upwards of $1 billion, but that it'll ultimately pay for itself through additional sales of gas.
For oil and gas, the pollutant is the product. So that's one of the reasons that EDF focuses on oil and gas methane emissions. It's a win-win situation. The planet benefits from less greenhouse gas emissions, but at the same time, the operators benefit because they have more efficient operations and can often sell more product.
The industry is in a period of retrenchment right now. There was just an absolute boom times a few years ago when people were just drilling like crazy. And that kind of rush contributed to the scale of the waste and emissions that we saw. The pandemic and lower oil prices has slowed that down.
Historic drop in crude oil prices. At one point, the price fell to a shocking negative $37 a barrel.
And even as prices now climb back up, the industry is sort of pledging not to go crazy again. But in a few years, when the next boom happens, either in the Permian or somewhere else, and there's real money to be made, are they going to show the same restraint that they're pledging right now? Or are they going to focus on the short-term bottom line, which is, let's just drill as fast as we can, and who cares if some methane leaks into the air?
People in the industry often say that they're actually working on this methane problem. Does that make you feel better? Do you feel like we're on the right track?
No, I've been hearing that for over a decade now. I've been hearing their promises for over a decade. It's like forgiving your cheating lover one more time.